Ladies and gentlemen, Kiwanians and guests, welcome to the Kiwanis Club of Kingsport's very first 2017 Candidate Forum. As Kingsport Kiwanians, we are very proud of having established a rich heritage of local and international service and of our strong commitment to our civic responsibility and this community. Next week, our forum...
Excuse me.
Oh, absolutely. Minor adjustment there. Next week, our forum will include the alderman candidates that are running for the two-year position, Mayor Clark, and the Kingsport School Board candidates. But let's get started by introducing our alderman candidates who are running for a four-year term. When I call your name, would you stand? Because I'm not sure everybody in the back is able to connect name and person. Dr. Jennifer Adler. Betsy Cooper. Rat Cross. Daryl Duncan. Robert Ellis. Colette George. Little fan in the audience again. Mark Vickers. And Dr. Robert Williams. For everyone's benefit, and again, for their candidates as well, the guidelines for today's forum include each candidate will have 90 seconds to provide an opening statement, 90 seconds to respond to each of the forum questions, and then 60 seconds for a final closing statement. Admiral John McKinley is the timekeeper, and this esteemed individual will give each speaker a 15-second warning alert. Please demonstrate once again, Admiral. Okay. Thank you, John. We will begin with opening statements for our candidates in the order that I introduce them. So, Dr. Adler, you are first. The other microphone.
Excellent. Well, there are good and bad things about your last name starting with A. My name is Jennifer Adler. I want to thank first the Kiwanis Club for organizing this candidate forum. What a great opportunity to get to hear from many of the candidates all at once. My work as an educator and my role as a parent motivated my decision to run for Kingsport Alderman. The main issues in my campaign are kids, community, and jobs. I hope to talk with you as the forum goes on today about more of those things in specificity, but I want to take a moment to suggest that picking up, there's a postcard on the back table back there. It has my web address listed on it. I know in 90 seconds I won't be able to tell you everything I want to tell you, so I'd encourage you to go to my website and read about what I identify as central issues for Kingsport, and I think even more importantly, what I identify as my core values. And some of those include transparency, fiscal conservancy, and partnerships. I spend every day talking with students, advising and mentoring them, and talking to them about how we can make a positive impact in the communities that we live in. It's easy to identify problems, it's hard to find solutions. And I talk to my students about the importance of identifying issues, gathering research, talking to experts, negotiating, coming to a consensus, and adjusting our plan. And I can tell you that's the same approach I would use on the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. I look forward to talking with everyone today and encourage if you don't get a chance to ask the question that you want to ask, please contact me and be more than happy to share more with you. Thank you so much.
We are transitioning. Betsy Moore Cooper.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to come and speak today. When I tell someone I'm running for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, I always get the same question. You know, what are you thinking? Why are you running for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen? Simply put, I'm running because I love Kingsport. I'm proud of its heritage and its history. I was born and raised in Kingsport. My husband was born and raised here. We raised our family here. And I'm deep-rooted in my hometown. I'm a product of Kingsport City Schools, and I taught for 31 years in that same system. After retirement, I knew I wanted to serve the community. I knew what my passions were. They were children and service. So I became a court-appointed special advocate for abused and neglected children in the Kingsport and Sullivan County court system. I was very active in my local church with missions. It's First Broad Street United Methodist Church, the church I was born into and have been a member of my entire life. I also was an adjunct professor for East Tennessee State University, supervising Residency 1 and Residency 2 student teachers in 7 local school systems. I was also elected to and served on the Kingsport Board of Education. I served on the governing STEM board, the cooperative venture between Sullivan County and Kingsport City to start Innovation Academy several years back. But most of my experience has been in education, but now I'm currently the director of First Broad Street Child Care Center, where I run. It's a small business. I have 20 staff, 80 students. I will tell you more later. Thank you.
Well, thank you, and Rat Cross, you are next.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having all of us today. I think this is a wonderful way for the community to get to know their candidates. My buddy and your member, Jeff McKee, informed me when I came in that you really didn't have a choice. And I've noticed that 90 seconds isn't a lot of time. And with the Admiral as the timekeeper, I know we're going to stay on track. But let me say, I know most of the people in here. The faces are familiar, and it's because I've been a public servant all my life. I've had the privilege of serving you through the 27-year career I had with the city of Kingsport, before that, a hitch in the United States Army Reserve. And I enjoy it. I love the personal contact. It's very demanding. And what I want to accomplish as a candidate is to continue to mold community through creative collaboratives, much as I did in my career with the city. I want to continue to bring entrepreneurs and families and businesses to Kingsport and place them in locally owned buildings and fill local landlord occupancy. So with that in mind, I want to help the community to become informed so they can be engaged in helping your government choose healthy next steps. This is a great time to be in Kingsport, and I think better than I've known in my history here. And lots of things are just beneath the surface, and we can look for those things to start blooming soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rack. And we will move alphabetically to Daryl Duncan.
On July the 21st, 2015, I was sworn in as a Kingsport City Alderman. That was one of the best days of my life. After living in this city for 37 years with my wife, Sharon, to be able to serve the citizens and community that has been so good to us, it was the highest of honors. I was a long-term employee of Eastman Chemical Company and retired last year and now employed by Save Inc., a large global chemical company. And by working with these two organizations, I have learned to work with large budgets and see how big business operates. I also have my real estate license and see the everyday demands of a small business like Town and Country Realty. Over the past 21 months, I've attended more than 430 events, from ribbon cuttings, ground breakings, work sessions, BMA meetings, representing the citizens in a manner of honesty and respect. I ask that you look at the progress that's been made over the last 2 years. Look at our downtown. We have new businesses, great places to eat, and now we have ETSU has joined our academic village. We have apartments being developed in our new professionals to assist with our housing needs. And we have a 5-year business plan that includes repairs, maintenance of our existing buildings, and allows the growth and progress in moving our city forward. All in the last 2 years. So let's continue this journey together and progress together. Today, as I humbly ask for your vote to allow me to represent the citizens of Kingsport for 4 more years.
I'm used to this transition. I'm used to coming right after Daryl for our votes. I'm Colette George with Blue Ridge Properties. I have been serving you as an alderman for the last 4 years. If you don't know where I stand on something, then you guys have not been paying attention, because I'm not very good at keeping my opinions to myself. and I also don't mind voting alone, which I quite often do. I believe in Kingsport. I ran to be an alderman because I love my community. I've worked with a lot of nonprofits and community organizations throughout Kingsport. I grew up here, went to school here, moved away and chose to come back so I could raise my boys here. Said, I do believe in this town. I want us to continue to move forward. I think we've done great things the time that I have been on the board for the last 4 years. There's still a long way to go on a lot of things. We always need to improve. We always need to get better. I'm here for the long run in that I just put a building on downtown Kingsport. So I know the challenges you face when you decide to develop in Kingsport for the good and bad, but I am thrilled to be downtown. I'm thrilled to be part of this community. And I hope that you all have at least appreciated my time on the board and will vote for me to be elected again. Thank you.
Howdy, y'all. My name is Mark Vickers. I'm running for alderman. I haven't sung God Bless America since I was probably 14, so thank you for that, by the way. Anyway, so I'm just going to give you a brief overview of who I am and where I come from. I was born and raised in Kingsport. I graduated from Dobbins Bennett in 2009. From there, I started my own business downtown. It's called Quality Fasteners. Actually, a lot of the nuts, bolts, screws, and everything that in this building right here actually came from me. Also, the press building and several other buildings. And there's actually a few people in this building that have bought nuts and bolts off of me. Anyway, I got offered to sell out by some competition. I sold out and I decided to go back to school, so now I am a student. I'm going to school at Northeast State and ETSU. I'm dual enrolled. I'll be going solely ETSU next semester. Probably going to take a summer break. I haven't took one of those in a while. But anyway, I believe in the infrastructure. We need to invest in infrastructure. That is our main key. We also need to diversify the economy. I feel like getting more technology jobs into this area would help attract the demographics that we are looking for in this area. And besides that, I just really love my community and feel like I could do a change. And then also I wanted to thank the cooks from Food City for this delicious food. The chicken is awesome. So thank y'all.
Hello, my name is Robert Williams. 43 years ago, my wife Ann and I came to Kingsport to raise our family and to establish a practice of medicine. We made the right choice. We're here today to convince you to vote for us in the upcoming May election. We all have our opinions about things such as infrastructure, jobs, economic development, and public safety. But there's a darker issue that needs attention, and that is the prescription opioid drug epidemic in our area. Unfortunately, we have the distinction of allegedly being the epicenter of that in the Southeast. Something not particular to be proud of. I was actually sparked into action a couple of months ago when I witnessed this ridiculous television ad put out by AstraZeneca, a big pharmaceutical company, advertising Movantik for opioid-induced constipation. There's this guy, Fred, that's a construction foreman on the job taking prescribed opioids for his chronic back pain. Fred obviously has a problem. We have a problem. Fortunately, even though this is a regional problem, we have solutions perhaps on the horizon with the East Tennessee State program and so forth. So, Robert Williams, Alderman May. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
I think to make this easy for everybody and to accommodate our media wishing the taped two microphones together. This time we will just go right down the line. And the question is, what are your qualifications to serve as an effective Kingsport alderman?
Thank you. Well, my qualifications involve the experience of service. I've served not only as a City of Kingsport employee and the administrative branch, but I started as a firefighter and EMT and then became fire inspector and arson investigator. So I understand public safety. And in the last number of years, I was happy to serve on nearly all of the Chamber of Commerce outreaches, including Move to Kingsport, Fun Fest, Keep Kingsport Beautiful, a couple of others that I don't recall immediately. And I've also been active at the state level with the Tennessee Department of Environment and Conservation, working as a member of their Executive Planning Commission for the state conference held in Kingsport, and also with TDOT, Tennessee Department of Transportation, on several grants that have landed here in Kingsport. And I'm a proud vice president of the Tennessee Ornithological Society, which recognizes Kingsport as building the first birding trail in the state. I'll mention this, if you know me, you know that I'm into birding, and that's a $1 billion a year industry. And Kingsport gets more than the average number of bird watchers, and that's because of our geographical blessing. These mountains put us in a flyway that caused not only the birds to flock here, but bird watchers. So that's one of the things that I want to forward and promote in Kingsport via my connections and experience, is to celebrate our opportunity for outdoor recreation to spawn a positive economic impact.
I want to highlight three things about my qualifications to run to be an alderman for Kingsport. The first is a little bit about what my job is day to day. I'm assistant director of the Roan Scholars Leadership Program at East Tennessee State University, where I help recruit, select, and develop young people to be leaders for our community. That position is an unusual position in that it's within an academic institution, but it is very community facing. So I routinely engage with people in the nonprofit sector, in the government sector, within businesses, within the community. And really much of my day-to-day job is connecting students with people within the region that I can think can help them develop into being leaders of impact as they go on. Because of that, I have a network of people, both here within Kingsport, but also in a much broader geographic area. And what it allows me to do is I can hear things that someone will be talking about where there's a connection between projects or goals or ideas. I think that my particular role with the Roan Scholars Program gives me a unique visibility into creating some of those regional connections that I think are important for Kingsport as we move forward. The second qualification may strike you as odd, but I am not a lifelong Kingsport resident, as you may have determined. We moved here 3 years ago. My husband was recruited by Eastman. We were looking for a place to raise our son that provided a good quality of life, good public schools. Having that perspective of someone from the outside who came here and chose to make our home here may add something in terms of what I can bring to the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. I also want to say I'm a parent, which I hope is also a qualification. Excellent. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. I believe I'm the senior member on this group, so that is a qualification. Mm-hmm. I'm also not only a father, but a grandfather. Qualifications. Well, as a physician, I deal with people, and it's one-on-one, generally. As in supervisory positions, I've served on several boards. The Kingsport IPA was the first HMO-type operation in Kingsport, and I served on that board. I was on the board of directors at Indian Path Hospital. I'm currently on the board of the AnuCare Collaborative, which is Mountain States Health Alliance organization for accountable care. I believe that progress in Kingsport depends on job development. Without job development, bringing in small business isn't going to work. We've had too much replacement going on in our community. For example, this building is on top of a previous factory. We're just about to fix a transportation system on top of another factory. What we've got to do is somehow, and I don't have the answer, but we've got to have jobs. That's the key to the future. In my opening lines,
I said that I'd worked, I was a long-term employee of Eastman, and now I work for Save. In both of those organizations, I learned to deal with large budgets. And that's what you deal with this, working for the city of Kingsport. To see large budgets, you have a lot of information coming at you very quick. It's much just like in the business world and like the city operates. I also think that you have to have good communication skills. You have to be able to listen. And you have to understand that everybody that's coming through the door is not going to agree with what you think. However, that person has a voice just like everybody else. Everybody has a voice and you need to listen to that. There's a lot of interaction with a lot of people, and I feel like I've worked hard to be able to do that, to understand from the highest of people we have in Kingsport down to the lowest. And I think that's been a part of my, at least being on the board, and what I'm proud of is being able to expand that and being honest and open and being very authentic with everybody.
I'm gonna stand. I enjoy standing a little more than I do sitting. Anyway, so what are my qualifications to be an alderman of the city of Kingsport? Well, for one, if y'all are familiar with any kind of construction projects in this area or construction companies, my family has a deep-rooted history in construction. There's Vickers Construction, Vickers Roofing, and it keeps going on down the line. We've been doing construction in Kingsport for over 80 years. I've been in every building in Kingsport, and I've seen every problem that there is. Well, almost every building. I can't say every building. But I see the problems with everything. And then you have nobody on the board right now that has a, for say, construction background. I've built the buildings. I've seen the buildings. I know the problems with the buildings. Most of downtown, the dirt is not good for building on. So you always have to do piers and various other things. And it comes as an unexpected cost to people that don't understand that. Second thing that goes towards my qualifications is I was a young entrepreneur until I sold out, and I guess I'm a past entrepreneur. But I do understand that the demographic that we are trying to recruit is my demographic. We want people in my generation to come in and influx our economy with younger people, because our demographic right now is mainly older people above 55. I think it's almost 40%. So, thank you.
I'm Colette George. Sometimes I don't think I'm qualified to get up in the morning. But you all did not impeach me, so hopefully that's a good thing. I have said I am from here. I think I'm really qualified more as a small business owner. I have worked in real estate and running Blue Ridge Properties for the last 24 years. And in doing that, I not only work as a realtor where I'm dealing with people and selling our city and explaining the benefits of coming to move your whole family here, but feeling their needs and listening to what they want. And I'm working with people that are selling the estate of their parents and the trauma they're going through. So I'm used to working with people in a lot of stressful situations, a lot of different times in their life. I also run the business, so I understand the budgets, I understand making payroll, I understand that sometimes you have to take risks to have good outcome, but also understand that you can't spend money you don't have. I'm not very good at spending other people's money. Apparently I'm a little bit better at spending mine, because I said I did just invest in a building. I do know a little bit about building downtown. Thank you GRC, or I would have to have known more. But I feel that I do know a lot of people here. I know a lot of the nonprofits and the different organizations because I've been involved and worked with them and supported them. And I feel I bring to Kingsport more of the wants and needs of a lot of people in a lot of different price ranges. And that's because that's who I work with. So I've just said I really do believe in the city. To you, Betsy.
Thank you. I'm Betsy Cooper, and earlier I went through all my education qualifications, but I want you to know I'm more than just an educator. Presently, I'm the director of First Broad Street Child Care Center. That's a small business. I have 20 staff, 80 children and their families that I work with every day, and I'm responsible for all the budgetary and financial responsibilities that go with that. In my two-year tenure, we've grown 32% in enrollment, and we've had double digits improvement in all fiscal measurements for the last 2 years. But 15 years ago, I guess another story about small business, 15 years ago when my husband was upper management at Kebacor, which is the parent company for Kingsport Press, and it was going to close, we were at a crossroads in our life. We had reasons to locate, or had opportunities to locate other places, but we chose to stay in Kingsport. We chose to invest in Kingsport. So Fred and I started out with a small building down 11W with four employees. Presently, he has Kingsport Book that has taken over the Hawkins County plant, the whole Hawkins County plant, with over 50 employees. It is a multi-million dollar business, and he pumps millions of dollars back into our local economy through payroll and local purchases. So, and right now, the Kingsport Book that was grown out of Kingsport Press closing is the only deluxe bindery in North America. Everyone else has left and gone offshore, but in our bindery is the only one left in North America. So out of the closure of Kingsport Press, we've grown it and invested back into our city.
Actually, I think we've seen the passion and the diverse and excellent qualifications that each individual brings to us. So again, thank you for the wonderful way you introduced yourself with your introductory statement, and also as you further clarified your qualifications. Our next question is, what do you see as the top two challenges facing Kingsport? And let us start, Rack, with you.
I get to go first again. So the top two challenges, in my opinion, facing the city of Kingsport include balancing the budget that keeps us fiscally responsible and able to deliver the services that we're expected to deliver as a city, while at the same time investing in amenities that make us attractive so that we can grow our economy and our population. As we know, we're no longer annexing, which was our primary tool for population growth. And now we're in a position that we must remain competitive with other markets and capture young families, as Mark said, that want to establish themselves in Kingsport and to increase our population organically. So I think that investing in outdoor recreation is going to link to a lot of those ideas that the millennials are looking for. They may have a laptop and can live anywhere and work at another location. So if we can attract them to Kingsport by just using what we have, enhancing our geographical blessing and also our sports background and history, I think we can grow our economy in that direction. Another challenge in Kingsport is progress in a way of shifting paradigms. We are Kingsport. We own the Kingsport spirit. But as we celebrate our 100th year, we're also looking forward to the next 100 years, and we're going to look different. And we need to support each other with information. Let's open up government and our minds and go forward.
We'll do this one more time.
The two issues I would highlight are kids and employment. From the perspective of, and I want to echo here some of Dr. Williams' comments, the opioid drug crisis is having a serious impact on many children in our community. I have talked with a number of teachers, for example, that face behavioral challenges, absent parents, and other things in the classroom. That's a real concern for me. So I want to applaud Dr. Williams for bringing attention to that. I think issues that we need to focus on are for the quality of life for all children in Kingsport, from the issue of addressing things like the opioid drug crisis, some of the negative impacts of some of our blighted communities and conditions that children are living in. I want to talk a little bit about, from the job perspective, of things that I think we need to focus on, and we've already heard some good comments on what it might mean to attract quality employment to Kingsport. My husband and I love to travel. And when we go someplace and see a company where it is, we always ask, why is it there, right? So Boeing, for example, is in the Pacific Northwest because there are trees. Kentucky has great bourbon and racehorses because it has tremendous calcium in its water, right? There's always an explanation for why someplace attracts the business that it has. I think Kingsport has done a lot in terms of thinking about what are our natural resources and sort of partnerships to attract jobs and businesses here. But I think there's more to be done on that front and to developing sort of industries, specific industries, that we can look to for future stable employment to improve the overall quality of life.
I would have to say the top two issues are jobs, and the second issue is jobs. Without jobs, all of these other things we're talking about could be out the window. By that I mean we basically now are a service economy. This used to be known as a mill town, but not anymore. Towns of this size are suffering all over the country for the same problems. Mark mentioned, I believe, about attracting youth. Most of our children reside elsewhere. There's nothing wrong with people my age. We live in a wonderful part of the world, and it's a great place to retire. We are a service economy. So I think we also need to work hard to make it more attractive to people from other parts of the country looking for a better place to live. We need to make Kingsport a place where people want to live, where people work and play.
I think the top two challenges that I see that we face is we're going to have to get more and more people to live here. We have 25,000 people per day that works here, but they don't live in our city. They live in Hawkins County, they live in Scott County, they live in Sullivan County, but they do not live here. We have to capture those people to get them to move here. And so that is part of the livability program that's run through One Kingsport. We need people to want to come to Kingsport to live. Our death rate has surpassed our birth rate this year by 150 people. This is going to be a problem. It's not going to be a problem today, but if you look at Kingsport long term, it is going to be a problem of a declining population that we have. So we've got to capture these people. Next, I agree we need jobs, but we can't look just to Kingsport as a job mechanism and hub for all of our jobs. We have networks that's working very hard every day along with our KEDB to try to get people to come to move to our region to build and supply our region with jobs. Network last year had 1,500 jobs that they had through businesses they acquired in our region. And so we need to work hard with networks to try to get people to do that. Some of those is actually come here in Kingsport with Alpha Natural Resources. So it's people to move here and it is jobs.
Nice vocabulary word right there, rack with paradigm. My professor at school would love that. Anyway, if I could use that, I would, but I'll just use it wrong. Anyway, so I think our two biggest challenges is catching up on infrastructure, to be honest with you. We've forgotten about our roads for such a long time, and this board has done a good job of trying to alleviate the problem by playing catch-up, but it's so hard to play catch-up when you're dealing with something that is so expensive as roads. Roads and water are the two most expensive pieces of infrastructure you could probably ever deal with. Because, you know, if it's concrete road, you got to tear it back up and then put it back down. It's not as easy as just paving right back over it, you know, because if you pave over it, it's just going to pop up in the next 2 or 3 years. So anyway, so that's the first major issue. The second major issue is we need to learn how to diversify the economy, add people to this area without annexation. Big thing is Dr. Williams said it was a service industry. We have went to a service-driven economy in America. Our manufacturing has tapered off to a little bit of nothing compared to our service industry now. So I would think of recruiting smaller tech companies to come to this area. I've got some ideas, but they're not fully fledged out yet. So, but those are my two big ideas for Kingsport, is just figuring out a way to diversify the economy. That way we're not focused on factories. Thank you.
Thank Thank you, Colette, George. I'm kind of going to echo what's already been said, and that obviously our big concerns are going to be quality jobs in this area and this region. And I think that's always going to be an issue when you deal with a small town. And we were, you know, when we did have Eastman, which we still have Eastman, but, you know, we have grown and we need a lot of diversity, and there's a lot of different companies and corporations helping work and networks to try to create jobs here. But quality jobs is an issue across the whole country. And as Daryl has said, you know, being both in real estate, we understand the importance of people choosing to live in Kingsport. We have jobs here, and people don't mind driving now. When I was growing up, I mean, going out to Central was, you had to decide if you wanted to go that far to go to a ball game. Now, you know, we're going to Chattanooga for a ball game. It's a different world, and we've recognized that. People don't mind driving. We have good interstates and roads to get people to work very quickly. And a lot of the people moving here are coming from cities where they're used to easily driving an hour a day. You know, I think if I have to go more than 5 minutes, it's just atrocious. But where they're coming from, it's a different, they're used to a different world. And we have to have the amenities in Kingsport to make people choose to live in our city limits so that we can have the funds to do all the things to make this a great place to live for everybody. Thank you.
I'm Betsy Cooper, and there's advantages and disadvantages of going last. First of all, most people, I can't disagree with anything that's been said. We need jobs, we need infrastructure, we need all the things that they've said. But I also know that we need to market what we are and decide what we are. Kingsport is unique. We have things in Kingsport that no other city can offer. We have an outstanding school system. We have Bays Mountain Warriors. We have a wonderful green belt that runs right along the river. We need to learn to market what we are and decide what we are. We have, because like I said, we have amenities in Kingsport that that a lot of our surrounding cities and places can't offer. They don't have those. We need to attract younger people to come and live where we do. I know that my youngest daughter just recently got married and moved back to Kingsport, so it did my heart well to see her move back here. She's a teacher at John Sevier Middle School now, and her husband is a pharmacist, and just recently, within the last 6 weeks, bought a local pharmacy. So to see young people coming back and invest in our community and to stay here, and it also lets me see through her eyes the things that we still need in Kingsport, the venues that would attract some of the younger people that we need to for our city to grow for the next generation. Thank you.
I'd say there's a big Vol fan right there. Thank you, Mark. Obviously, the complexity of the issues that were mentioned are issues, and we're happy to have our city manager and our mayor here as well. You've heard the scope and the passion with which people identified and gave personal comments and reflections. So again, thank you in terms of showing the research you've done and the awareness you have of the challenges that you would be facing if you were elected to a position on the board. And having heard very carefully that Betsy said what it means to be last, she's going to be first this time. But the question is, in recent years, the city has been quite active in using pilots, TIFs, and other incentives to attract new development to come to Kingsport. Heard those words just a minute ago. Do you think these tools should be used? And how do we balance this practice with support for our existing businesses?
I shouldn't have opened my mouth and just been pleased with going last. I think we need to take every opportunity that we can to use the grants or the things that are offered that are, instead of some of the taxpayers' money, to increase our local business. I know that you there's a fine balance. You can't bring other businesses in and hurt the businesses that are already here that are trying to start and to get developed, so that you walk a fine line. I think as Kingsportians, we need to support the businesses that are here. Instead of, because every time you go out to eat at another place or buy somewhere else, you're giving that city your tax money. So we need to educate the taxpayers here that if you live in Kingsport, you know, be loyal, buy local, that we need to really push that. But I think that we can, there's enough opportunity that and enough need that we can bring other businesses in and use all the resources that are available to encourage other places, people to come here and start in Kingsport.
Thank you. Colette George. It's very competitive out there. Every city is competing, and every city has pilots and TIFs to offer. That being said, I'm probably, you know, very conservative and very much a capitalist. I feel that if an individual is going to come in, if the business will make it and it's what we need and it's a for-profit business, then that individual should, you know, why should we take other people's tax money to make him more profitable? I mean, I think you have to look in terms of, in my opinion, it goes to job creation, what you get for the return. So when you look at what we give, what benefit does everyone else in Kingsport get from it? Will it bring in enough to justify what we invested in? I feel very strongly, too, that we need to look at out-of-town investors and in-town investors the same. I think we have a tendency to feel like and people outside of our area are brilliant, wonderful, and terrific and deserve everything to get them to come in, when we have some wonderful, talented people here that are willing to invest their personal money to make this a better place. So I think each project needs to be looked at individually, and I do think you need to look at it as if you're spending your own money, and would I be willing to give up this much of my personal money to back this project based on the outcome?
Hi, y'all. I actually did a speech on TIFs 2 days ago in my economics class, so I'm fresh on this one. All right, so some of the points on that speech, though, was that I don't think TIFs should be used for private investment. For one, it starts bidding wars between cities, and you saw that a lot with the Pinnacle, you know, $9 million, $30 million, all these people throwing numbers around. And it got into a bidding war, people fighting to get that development. And I just don't think that's fair to the taxpayers in general to pay for something that they'll never own. It's not part, they'll never own it. It's not a government building, it's private investment. If you use TIFs for schools and roads and stuff like that, I'm completely fine with that. That's what they were meant to be. Another thing is that it goes against completely our American idea of a free market economy. A free market economy, the government's not supposed to interfere with businesses. So we as a government decide, oh, Jim Bob gets the money, but Joe Beth doesn't. Why? Colette talked about fairness between local investors and outside investors. And I feel like, I do feel like that we give the outside investors the benefit of the doubt before we give the local investors. And I feel like that's one major problem with TIFs, and they're sticky and icky, and I don't like them. So, thank you.
I don't know of anyone that really likes a pilot or a TIF. But I do know that that is the environment that we live in. And I think we have to look at our lives and see how we conduct business ourselves. We do our banking online. We can buy a car from our sofa. And so our lives has changed. And so has being competitive with these developers. These developers, if you don't offer some kind of money for them, they will move on. They'll go to Johnson City or they'll go to Bristol. I use what Mark said here to look at the Pinnacle. And so we don't have the Pinnacle, and retail is a problem for us right now. It really is. And so in each case, I look to see what the benefit and the economic impact of that TIF or that pilot program is. And so if you use the Bray property down here that's going to be developed for the apartments just right down here, we gave them a pilot program for that. The economic impact, the first year, it cost $32 million to build it, $48 million total. That's $16 million of economic impact the first year that goes back to our city. On the day that they sign, it's $1.1 million erased from our city debt because they're purchasing the land from us. So I think you have to look at the value of what you're getting for the TIF money and then make a decision on it.
Robert Williams. I'm going to try standing up since I didn't do so well on the sitting down part. I would like to echo what Colette said. I would have voted with you on the issue of the apartment complex. I would have perhaps agreed to 5 years, maybe 8 years, but 20 years is too long. I think we should always practice the basic rule of wing walking, biplanes. You don't let go of what you've got until you've got hold of something better. The Kingsport Town Center comes to mind, and our new mall out east. So I think if there is a need for a service, someone will step up. Doing incentives to bring something in where there may be a need, I think, is ill-advised.
Excellent. So I would echo many of the comments that have been made already about the importance of focusing on return on investment in terms of offering these sort of tax breaks or other incentives. And also, I think the comment is very true that we are competing against other cities. And so we find ourselves maybe stuck in a situation where to compete, we may not necessarily do the sort of purest approach of a free market, which I think many of us would prefer. I sort of imagine, this is a spectrum that I think applies to a lot of things in city government. You can spend a lot of time thinking about attracting people to come here, but you may lose focus on the people that are here, right? If I'm constantly thinking about how I'm going to attract others, and I think personally speaking, my tendency is to focus on the sort of return on investment for our money for the people that are here. And that does require visioning and thinking about where Kingsport is going, but I don't ever want to lose sight of that, that getting so caught up in attracting others that we lose sight of that. One other small point on this to take it into a slightly different place, there was some discussion about how do you get people to live in Kingsport and to move to Kingsport. I would have loved an incentive to move to Kingsport, right? Wouldn't we all, right, to love an incentive? But that actually came up in some of the One Kingsport discussions about asking businesses to incentivize people to move to Kingsport. And so as we think about business incentives, I also want to put out there on the table that there's also this issue of residential incentives as well.
Thank you. Rack Cross. The question was, do the candidates feel like TIFs and pilots should be used? And my answer is yes. We're in a market. We're in a competitive market. And if we want to land some businesses, the other side of capitalism is who is receiving the incentive. And they also are shopping the market to see where they want to land. So certainly these need to be evaluated on a case-by-case scenario. And we need to choose the ones that benefit Kingsport. And I certainly don't think that we're choosing to not benefit Kingsport when we recruit business or industry with incentives. So that being said, I certainly do agree that we should find a balance. We'll strike a balance with who we already have, with our local business people. I know John Campbell's here with the executive director of Excel Now, helping our new businesses start up, which typically fail at the rate of about 90%. With the tools that they're able to offer new business startups and entrepreneurs, we're looking at a potential 70% success rate. Building our local economy, John's office is over there at Sync Space on Sullivan Street. I encourage you to drop by and find out a little bit about what's going on over there. It's very exciting. And also, growing the local economy in the way of recognizing who we are. I want to introduce a much stronger revenue stream, literally and figuratively, by building a river recreation culture. And that's already started. We have an entrepreneur here today, Craig Widener. Please say hello to Craig when we dismiss.
Thank you. Each and every one of you, the complexity of that question, the need for educating the general citizenry, and thank you to the media for being here today, about how one responsibly balances that particular question. It's obvious that each of our candidates loves Kingsport and is interested in its best being. At this point, we are going to move to our closing statements, and I think I'm going to move it around just a little bit more. And Daryl Duncan, let's let you start with your closing statement, and I would suggest you stand.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you, Mary Lee. Honesty, integrity, stewardship, respect. That has been my core values that I've used while serving on the board of mayor and aldermen over the past 21 months. By using these principles, I've been able to serve this city in a manner that citizens want and deserve. But by being a long-term resident, I can remember the water bursting from the streets and an aging infrastructure. I can remember our downtown not looking like it does today, where we have new businesses, development, restaurants, boutiques, and coffee shops. Oftentimes, we have to know where we've been to know where we're going. I've built relationships with city leaders and leaders of the largest companies and visited our low-income and depressed neighborhoods. So today I'm asking each of you to allow me to continue to make a positive impact for the community that I love and to our citizens. I am leadership that listens. I would love to thank the Kiwanis for allowing us to be here today, and thank you for your community service.
I know firsthand how success can be achieved when local businesses work together with the business community in our area and the support of the city government. My husband and I live it every day. I pledge to be the voice for the citizens of Kingsport, and I'll work tirelessly to move our city forward. I have no political aspirations beyond serving Kingsport. I'm not a politician. I'm just here because I love the city that I grew up in. I entered this race for one reason, to make a difference. I'm proud to call Kingsport home. I'm proud of all the things that Kingsport has to offer, our exceptional world-class school systems, our outstanding police and fire department, our Parks and Recreation Department, our Public Works Department. I know how each of these arms of government need to work together to make Kingsport, to keep Kingsport strong. And I'll do my best to do the best for you. Your vote of confidence in me is a vote for the voice for Kingsport.
Mark Vickers.
Okay, I'm next. This Russian roulette that we're playing. So.
Well, in my closing statements, I would like to say that I would love to serve you all as a community. Like I said, I grew up in Kingsport. I actually am an Eagle Scout at the troop that meets at her church, to be honest with you, Troop 51. I lost my train of thought. Anyway, I would love to be the young voice on the board to help attract these young entrepreneurs, because I have a few friends that feel like they're left out in our local government because there's not any voice, there's not anybody young like me, and quite frankly, probably dumb enough to run for alderman. But anyway, so if you all have any questions, feel free to contact me anytime. I'll give any of y'all my phone number, and thank y'all.
Colette George.
Oh, this way. There we go.
I'm Colette George, and most days of the week I have truly enjoyed serving you as an alderman, and I would like your vote to continue. I believe in Kingsport. I am not afraid to ask questions. As you know, I vote the way I feel is in the best interest of the citizens that I serve. I'm always open to listening to new people, and I plan on being here a very long time, so I want to make this city successful. So thank you for your vote.
Thank you. Well, this has been interesting
and even entertaining. To the Cooper family, someone had told me about the book manufacturing plant down the road just a few days ago, and that was a very interesting story, and that's the kind of story we need to hear, is it not? Well, I would just like to say that 2 months ago, I had no plans of running. I'm obviously not a politician. I'm a novice. But this drug business has really got my goat. And I believe that I can manage the affairs that come before me as an alderman in a proper manner. And I will assure you I'll place special emphasis on this drug problem. Thank you.
Excellent. Well, I want to thank the Kiwanis Club for organizing this opportunity. I also want to thank many of the people sitting in this room. I recognize that our decision to move to Kingsport because we love the quality of the public schools, we love the possibilities for outdoor recreation, and we also sensed a tremendous sense of community spirit is because of the work that many of you all have carried out over the years. There are people in this room that have served on the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, that have been mayor, that have led Rotary and Kiwanis and all sorts of organizations, and you, the work that you all did is why we chose to move here. Kingsport needs a new generation of people that feel an equal commitment to seeing the city move forward and be a great place for all people to live. I hope that my decision to run maybe inspires some more young parents, young family members to run for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. I think that diversity of perspective is important as we think about the future of the city. So thank you so much. I would encourage you, if you did not get a chance to ask a question you wanted again, please come see me afterwards. I'd love to talk more with you. Thank you.
And let's see who would be next.
I'll do it.
Okay, good volunteer.
Thank you. Well, it is a pleasure to be here. Please help me out by picking up some of my campaign material on a table in the back. And as I told you, I'm a community servant, a servant leader, and I recognize a lot of your faces, and that's because I recognize you as also servant leaders and people that help Kingsport be who it is. This club is evidence of that, and this is the kind of community gathering and the sharing of information that will give us an informed community that can become an engaged community. I want to lead Kingsport in the direction of becoming an and community. I'd like for us to have more and opportunities and fewer or. And when we heard about several opinions here, we were having to put ourselves in a position of or, and I'd like to be in a position of and. Also, I'd like for you to vote for me in confidence because of my experience. I have brought entrepreneurs to Kingsport, multi-million-dollar projects. I'll continue to do that. And regardless of the result of the election, I want to grow Kingsport in a positive direction. Thank you.
Thank you. And I would be remiss at this moment to not thank our esteemed Admiral. Could you join me in applause for the good work that John did for us? Duly noted. As was said earlier by several of the candidates, they have agreed to visit with you one-on-one following our meeting today, and we encourage you to do that, perhaps to ask them to further expand an issue that they raised. And so, ladies and gentlemen, at this time, would you please join me in giving a big Kiwanian thank you to our candidates.